welcome to the Q A Café, coming to you today from the Georgetown Club in Georgetown, who I thank very much for giving us a new home here. This is our last show of the summer. We'll resume again in the fall. So it only made sense to focus on something that's one of my favorite subjects, and that is sports, especially DC sports. And we have two guests today who I listen to on the radio. I actually leave my job at Washingtonian and get in the car and drive around so that I can listen to
them. You don't really, do you?
Sometimes. Okay. But it's Kevin Sheehan and Thom Loverro of the Sports Fix. But I also download your podcast, but it's so late, it's a little out of date sometimes. So welcome.
We're outdated occasionally, too.
I want to put a disclaimer at the beginning that even though I love sports and consider myself a sports fan, I really don't know what I'm talking about half the time. So just kind of play along.
So why are you having us on?
Yeah, well, right. Neither do we.
Because you're
we just fake
do,
it well.
I'm just driving. You're going to do all the work. But it'll all work out in the end. But so welcome. Drink up. We're having a liquid lunch here, so cheers.
Yes,
good
cheers.
To meet you both.
We are.
Mm-hmm.
Cheers.
Mm-hmm. You don't have
Get
to go
Tommy
back
another
to work
one?
Today. Yes.
Pretty early.
Obviously, we want to talk about all DC sports, but there's only one DC sport that I guess that matters, and that's where we should begin. But I wore
Benghazi.
My Nationals T-shirt so that so I can remind you to change the subject at some point. But this has been whatever time frame we're in. It's going to be a very interesting summer and fall for the Redskins on two fronts. It's going to be the political side of it, what to do about the damn name, and then there's going to be the other side of how is RG3. How's he going to be? How's the team going to be? How's Gruden going to be? Take your pick where you want to start.
Where do you want to start?
Well, one of my points would be that's too much for any fan to have to burden. That's too much. I mean, it's bad enough to have to carry the burden of the football side.
Yeah.
And now you're dragged into the politics of it. And that's a big weight for any fan base, even one as great as this one.
And could be tiring, don't you think?
One of my points is I think it's going to get there's going to be an exhaustion level at some point where people are just going to get tired of getting beat up, even if they think it's unfair.
And won't that be even greater if the team should do well? Doesn't the political tension ramp up if the team has a really great season?
Yeah, will the president invite them to the White House if they win the Super Bowl?
Well,
I mean, it's
I think
all
we know the
things.
Answer to that.
But it's all those things. Yeah, you start to get concerned. I'm a fan. I've been a fan. I'm born and raised Washingtonian. And Tommy's not a Redskin fan.
What are you then?
Look, I always tell people, I root for me.
Yeah, he's a fan.
whatever works best
he's
for me. That's who I root for.
Yeah.
If it happens to work out good for me, then yeah.
Which is why he loves the controversy.
Okay.
Because that's rooting for him. Stir. It's better for the show.
Yeah.
But yeah, I get concerned about the things like if they're really good and the attention, more of the attention will be paid to them and the negative part of the name. And you don't want that. I mean, the last time they won the Super Bowl in Minneapolis in 1992, there were a handful of protesters outside of the Metrodome before the game, but it wasn't
like this.
Yeah, so we don't know what it would be, but it'll be more.
Congress involved and the federal government involved, and does it affect the game of the players? Is there a tipping point where it begins that, you know, I mean, like right now, for example, Tony Wiley, he's the press guy for the Redskins. Is anybody allowed to do interviews without him sitting right on their shoulder for fear that the question might be asked about the name?
You know, I don't know if they are or not, but that's not particularly unusual anymore in this day and age in sports. It's not just the Redskins. I could tell you that if you're interviewing the Washington National or the Washington National Manager, there's a PR guy right there.
Yeah.
It's become more of a practice than ever before.
Well, then let me ask it another way. Do you think that the Redskins players are getting briefed on how to handle this?
I would say with respect to this issue, yes.
Yeah, that's
I mean, I would say that the briefing is don't answer it, deflect it. You can't win either way by having a position
but
on this issue.
But that puts a little bit of that same kind of, you know, fatigue could happen to them too. You know, we're getting tired of defending the name.
It's really ramped up in recent months. If there's fatigue, it's because of what's happened in the last couple of months. Tommy's convinced that the players and the fans are going to get fatigued from this issue and are going to finally just give in and say, just change it already because we're getting tired defending it.
But it makes so much sense. I don't agree with him. But why not? I mean, change it already. Yeah, just change it. I mean,
why?
We did it with the Wizards. Well, because it's broken. It's not working. And it's going to become more broken.
I think the perception is that it's broken. I think that there's an avalanche of perception that the debate about the name has already been solved. It's already been decided. And I think that a lot of Redskin fans who have a vested interest in this because they followed the team, you know, for a long time, I think they understand that it's a much grayer issue than that. I think the people on the name-changing side have forced down the throats of the people that are in favor of keeping the name more recently than ever. Listen, the name is insensitive. It's clear-cut. It's been decided when it really hasn't been decided. There's no proof. There's no support for that notion.
That's debated, though.
But at least you admit that it's a debatable issue.
Yeah.
The people on the side of changing the name have gotten so chesty to the point where they want you to just take their word for it as if this is a Jim Jones Kool-Aid session and just drink it. It's fine. It's been decided, and I think that it's much more nuanced than that.
But would you agree or disagree that we are in an era when the piling on starts, the piling on only increases until the objective is reached?
Even if it's unfair piling on.
Again, that's a subjective, you know.
True.
It's just that we, you know, I'm not going to compare the Redskins' name to Sterling because it is different. But, you know, just there becomes such a media storm. I mean, that Sterling was at the most heightened stage of it. We're still at a very early stage of it. And again, I don't think this would become heightened until it was a Super Bowl situation.
It's and I wrote about this, if you want to read my column, in the Washington
and
Times.
And the Washington Times, absolutely.
The social media changes everything this time around. You can throw a rock in a pond every day, and it could become a tidal wave with social media. I mean, it's just viral. It's just everything goes viral. You know what every celebrity is saying about it, and I don't see that changing. I think it's the social media component, and also I think the effort to have the name changed this time is much better organized and much better funded by the casino interests of the United Nations. I think that they have the power and the money to step up this fight.
There was the issue of the patent and the trademarks and all that, but what I've gathered is that that's not going to be the thing that makes the difference, because it's, again, it's nuanced. Even if the team were to lose on appeal, everything still rolls ahead. But what I'm curious, I see three components, and I'd like you to like pick one of them or all of them to address what it means to the issue. The trending public corporate sentiment, which is a little bit we've been touching on, the money, and the owner. Pick one. And
Kevin's probably better at talking about the money because he's got more of a business background and has a pretty good understanding of what's at stake here.
Well, I mean, I think you're right. I think this doesn't change until there's pressure, monetary pressure from big sponsors.
And like Nike saying.
And the other 31 NFL owners look at Dan Snyder and say, it's starting to hurt us now. And I think until that happens, nothing's going to change. Tommy, I think a lot of people disagree with that and think it will change before then. I think it's going to take real, meaningful monetary pressure for that to happen. We have not seen any indication that that's going to happen. That it has happened, because it hasn't. We also don't know that if certain advertisers pull out, that there aren't many advertisers waiting to step into those very spots. The NFL is a powerful brand, and the opportunity to be associated with it is a big deal for advertisers. So my sense is that we're much further away from that than most people feel right now in the moment. The other issue is the Redskins' overall value and what happens to that value if they change their name. If you talk to real branding people in companies like Procter & Gamble and Coke and, you know, Nestle and Pepsi, they will tell you there is huge risk, massive risk, when you change something significant associated with a brand.
But Philip Morris changed their name to Altria.
But that's a corporate name. That's okay, not a consumer product name.
Nobody's walking around wearing Philip Morris jerseys.
No, that's right. No, and definitely not Altria. Yeah.
There's a reason.
It does happen.
There's a reason Macy's and McDonald's and Coke don't change their name. Yeah. And it comes down to you have a fiercely loyal fan base, consumer base. And if you change something significant associated with that brand, they become less emotionally attached.
Is it generational at all?
I don't know if that's generational. It may be. It could be. I could be speaking from the perspective of having been involved in this brand as a fan for my entire life. And if it changes and it's not Redskins Cowboys, but it's the Washington Monuments versus the Cowboys, it doesn't seem like the same. And that's what the brand people will say is the risk.
Don't you think if they were winning that would you know, make everybody forget the name issue.
In fact,
I mean, if they changed the name and they were winning.
When you talk to branding people, they will say the risk is huge unless you win big immediately.
Okay.
In other words, if the new Coke tastes really good,
right,
then you're okay.
Then you're okay.
But when
that's exactly what it is.
Then you're back to the old.
That is a perfect analogy.
Now let me paint another scenario for you.
Mm-hmm.
I could be extreme about this. And I'm not saying it's a reason you shouldn't change the name, but let's say they change the name, and let's say you've got 60,000 people showing up at FedEx Field wearing war paint and headdresses, singing Hail to the Redskins from beginning to end of the game for their protest of their anger that their team's
would
name
would they be
changed.
All be getting paid on the side by Dan Snyder?
I don't think you'd have to.
I think you would see an enormous sense of public outrage displayed. Again, not a reason whether you should change it or not, but I think if you think this is ugly, I think you haven't seen ugly until you do change the name.
Can Roger Goodell make a difference? Does he have any leverage over Dan Snyder?
He doesn't think it should be changed
at
this point.
But I know that's his public position, but you know, there've got to be meetings that go on that we don't, you know, aren't privy to, where they have to look at this in a long-term way, don't you think?
See, I think like the your take on it is part of what that whole category of name changers, and I don't say that in a critical way, because Tommy knows if there was actual evidence and proof that this was every time I said go Redskins or I sung Hail to the Redskins at a game that I was insulting a group of people, I'd want the name changed tomorrow. But there's this assumption that it's insensitive. You have to change it. And I think that assumption is ill-founded. It's not based on fact. And I think Roger Goodell in the NFL has said that. One of the senior VPs in the NFL said recently, this is not the point-blank situation, and he was trying to say the black-and-white situation that some want to make it to be. It's much more nuanced. There's a lot of gray, and there are a lot of perspectives, including all of the recent polling, which suggests that Native Americans themselves were the most recent polling we have, which is, you know, 10 years ago, I'll grant you that, that not only do they think the name's not insensitive, but at a 90% rate, they think that it's fine. So where is the data that says that opinion has massively shifted? I haven't seen it yet.
So you two have opposing views on this. And then
Tommy doesn't think it should be changed either.
I don't think that it's certainly as clear-cut that everyone makes it out to be. I think there's a lot of hypocrisy in the change the name debate that angers me more than anything. I think you've got a lot of people that could have cared less about Native Americans before somebody told them this was important and will go back to caring not a single whit about them after this is over. And that bothers me a lot. Again, it's not my team. I don't have a horse in the race.
Your station is WTEM, and that's owned by Dan Snyder?
It's owned by Red Zebra, which Dan Snyder is the majority owner of.
Do you feel that at all?
Not at all.
There's no.
Remarkably, not one iota. I mean, if you listen to the show,
I do.
You've heard how critical that we can be.
But I wondered if
not a.
So you can go there if you want to.
Yeah,
we've been. Red Zebra acquired the station, then acquired 980 in 2008, but was launched in 2006. And I tell all these people that say, well, you're agendized. You're told what to say. Dan Snyder, in the 8 years that he's owned the radio station, I think has stepped inside in the building once And not one person on the air has ever gotten a call from anybody saying you can't say
that. Well, you don't have to step inside to have an influence.
No, that's true, but there hasn't been.
But there has not been one lick of it.
And since we mentioned his name, I think with some people, I think the opposition to the name or wanting the change is not entirely driven by their feelings about Native Americans as much as their dislike for Dan Snyder.
I think that's fair.
They want to see him lose this one because they just don't like him.
Yeah, I think that's legitimate. And, you know, that they're not going to get the benefit of the doubt from anybody on anything on this because of the track record of the owner. And I think in part and play, I think for the other NFL owners, this is going to come into play. Look, it's not a coincidence that the Redskins got hammered by NFL owners for not going along with their little plan for the salary cap penalty. They got hit hard for not going along with the collusion that the rest of the owners said that they would do. I think that gives you an idea, at least a barometer, as to how much sympathy Daniel Snyder's going to get among his fellow owners. I don't think there's going to be a lot.
I
think you hit on something. I think a lot of the opposition is potentially sort of a personal thing with the owner, but the irony of it is that those that are in favor of the name staying find themselves aligned with the owner maybe for the first time. You have a lot of Redskin fans that don't like the owner but are glad that he's the owner with respect to this issue because of the way he feels. You could have had an owner that said, let's just change it. It's not a big deal. And I think still, I Tommy may disagree, but I still think the majority of the fan base wants the name to stay.
I agree with them. I mean, I think they are. And I think that was the whole Redskins pride tweet that made people think backfired out of Redskins' part. But I think it was the idea that the fan base needs to wake up because this is a real threat. I think they were trying to wake up their core.
One last sort of business question, and then we'll actually talk, on the fields. But where does it stand, the idea of bringing the team back into D.C.? Is that even remotely in play?
Part of it is tied to the Olympic movement. They want to have the Olympics.
Is that Jack Evans giggling across the room?
I'm sure Councilmember Evans knows my views about the Olympics, and I don't think they're the same as his. But I think that's in part, the last time around, the notion was the Olympic Stadium would wind up being in some, machinations, the new home of the Redskins. The name, if it's still an issue then, is certainly going to complicate that
a lot. Right. Yeah, that's going to be an impediment, period.
I wonder if there's, with this U.S. patent and trademark cancellation of the marks recently, if the Redskins win that on appeal, if in some ways that brings sort of a blessing in disguise conclusion in a positive way for the Redskins, because if you get a court that says the last time they went through this, they won on appeal, and not only did they win on appeal, but the written opinion was very strong in their favor, saying that there's no evidence that suggests that this is disparaging to what they call the substantial.
But wasn't it a technicality?
Composite.
I don't know what the technical.
No, that was part of it, but the other part was they didn't have the evidence.
Yeah, the judge went out of his way to write an opinion that he felt that they didn't make their case.
So I wonder if they get the same judgment, would that be a helpful event and start to change the narrative? Probably not. But they could use that.
Do you think we'll see the Redskins or whatever the team is called back in D.C. in 10 years, 20 years?
Wouldn't you love to see it?
Oh, I loved it when it was.
It was the best.
The whole dynamic of the city was different. And, of course, I was here in the 80s when they were winning, and Jack Kent Cook was the owner, and we thought we hated him.
Yeah, right.
I mean, that's the laugh.
Right.
It's amazing how warm and fuzzy he's become as the years have gone by.
But what I loved was you could get to the game like that. And then after the game, everybody filled up in the bars. I mean,
yes.
Jack, Jack and his wife were down at Morton's, you know. I mean, it was just, it felt so inclusive and cozy and wonderful, and the players were out getting drunk all over town. And
right.
It was wonderful. It's the way it should be. But
I would leave the house at noon for a 1 o'clock game and be in my seat at 12:45.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Driving through the city. Everybody had their own way to get to the stadium. I would love to see that happen again.
I think they're locked into the lease with Prince George's County at FedEx Field for maybe another 13 years.
2026.
Thank you.
Okay.
I think he
So is my math right?
12.
Okay, 12. That was pretty close.
Okay.
So I do think that everyone would like to have the team back in D.C., but I think that they need to get off that Olympic bandwagon and figure out another way to do it, because that's a non-starter.
Well, let's get off business and talk, you know, the field. And, I mean, my first question is Mike Shanahan officially gone, out of the house, forgotten about? They've cleaned out every last vestige of him, and nobody misses him? Or how's that transition going?
I miss him. Kevin
misses him.
Okay.
I'm definitely in the minority on that. I thought he was a hell of a coach. I think he's changed the culture of the franchise to a certain degree. The way it ended was very ugly. And he took the immature route out of town, mm-hmm. and I will grant you that. But it really changed a year ago in the summer of 2013 when they were all in for week one for the quarterback to start, mm-hmm. and really rallying around an Adidas marketing campaign rather than focused on beating the Eagles. Because I bet if you ask Mike down the road and if he ever writes a book about this, he'll say the biggest mistake he ever made was not saying to whomever it was pushing him to start Robert Griffin III in week one, he's not starting, he's not ready, and our team's not better off with him starting the season. But they went down that path, and the season got away from them, and it turned very ugly between the quarterback's family, mm-hmm. and Mike and Kyle.
How long does he have to stay silent for?
I mean, Mike?
Mike, there's a period of time where before the contract's fully done.
He's only got one more year left on the contract.
This is it. This
so
year.
He could conceivably talk.
I mean, if there's a confidentiality clause in the contract, who knows?
Do
we know what he's doing? Is he just living in Denver?
I think he's counting
$7 million
for next year.
Right. Well, you know,
I think some people believe he'll coach again next year.
But he has to wait for that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, he doesn't. If he were to take a job, which he didn't this year, mm-hmm. he could have, but he would have foregone the $7 million, or there would have been a difference paid between his new contract and the
Kyle
old one.
He's
the offensive coordinator in Cleveland.
Right. And he's going to be working with
Johnny Manziel.
Do you like Johnny Football?
I like him. I'm not as big a college football fan as Kevin, but
he transcends college football.
He reminds me.
You don't even have to watch him play to be interested.
He reminds me of a midget Joe Namath.
You think eventually we'll be seeing him in a giant fur jacket?
I like quarterbacks with some style. And it's hard to differentiate in these days between style and show.
Yeah.
So I don't know if it's just show or style. But I think that's a guy that if he's successful in Cleveland, I mean, which is one of the great football towns in America, I think that'd be great for the NFL.
Is there reason to believe he can do it?
I love him, too. I mean, he's a winner. He's a competitor. And he's got an offensive coordinator, Kyle, who's worked with sort of this type of hybrid quarterback before. Yeah, mm-hmm. I think it's a good thing. Tommy's right, though. If there is a more deserving fan base in the NFL than Cleveland to finally have a winner, it'd be hard to name him. But I like Manziel. I hope it works out.
Yeah. Well, back to the Redskins and the coach. So, Gruden, I take it you've met him, hung out with him. What's your...
We haven't hung out with him too much point.
No.
But he seems like a great guy.
Yeah, he moved in next door to RG3, I'm told. He bought a place in Creighton Farms, and they're like next door neighbors.
He better win.
They better like each other.
They better like... Well, that's the key relationship. They have to get along.
Well, what are you hearing about that?
That they're getting along.
Yeah.
And that the fit is right chemistry-wise.
How's RG3's dad getting along?
We haven't heard that take place yet.
No news is good news, right?
Well, you know, look, the Redskins specialize in being happy in the offseason. Now, let's see what happens.
Great at that.
Like the first first preseason game, the second preseason game, if things aren't going so well and we start, you know, hearing little things here and there, if the dad shows up in the locker room like he did after one game last year where no other player's was allowed in the locker room. What I find interesting
about
the whole...
Maybe they should have Dad's Day.
Yes, they should. Get it out of the way.
They should.
You know? Why not Mother's Day, too, then?
Yeah.
I find interesting about the Shanahan... The narrative that's come out of Redskins Park ever since Mike was fired is that, I mean, he was evil. He was like the bane of everyone's existence.
Well, yeah. Well,
and I mean, now it's, I call it Shawshank Park. Because, I mean, you know, everyone's walking around like they're Andy Dufresne on a beach in Mexico saying, wow, we're free. And I'll be curious to see if that's really the case or not.
Well, you know, I mean, well, Griffin, I don't know that you can tell anything in the summer, but I guess you can tell something. Is he playing without the knee brace?
Yes.
He is. So
he's without the knee
brace. Is that an issue that's off the table, do you think?
We think so.
Yeah.
And it may have been a much bigger impact on the season last year.
It may have really hurt him a lot.
Yeah.
I think
You think he should have played without it?
No, but it just impacted his performance. He had to wear it.
Yeah, he looked miserable.
Reasons.
Right.
Yeah.
I think he should.
Have you ever tried to do anything with the knee brace on? Well, then imagine playing.
It's very restrictive, yeah. This season is on him. I mean, people can say it's on the new coach.
How's he handling that? How are they handling that? You know, we've watched him go through phases. You know, there was R3 Jesus, or whatever you all were calling him. And I point at you, but
I think that
was Tony Kornheiser, actually.
Probably.
Unbridled something another. But
optimism.
Optimism.
Yeah.
But there was that phase. Then there was we killed him, or we almost killed him.
Right, right.
Yeah.
And then there was the PR campaign to come back from death, which was overblown, and a kind of a... season, would you say it was just...
Oh, it wasn't a very good season.
It was more...
It was bad.
Okay.
It was
so,
bad,
you know, so
around.
Now you want to think that there's maturity that's in the equation, right? That this is going to be... I guess you'd want to think he's approaching this with a different mindset.
We're hoping that he knows his why at this point. Hashtags know your why.
One of the many hashtags that he puts out on social media.
Yeah, he does love Instagram and...
He's young.
He's fun.
I mean, I think a lot of what's happened the last year and a half at 30, 35, he'll probably look back on and say, really? I made a one-hour documentary about my rehab after one season?
But in this era of sports, you don't really necessarily have that. I mean, I was just reading that Tom Brady is going to start this season at age 37, you know, but how many actually make it? Maybe more and more do, but that's remarkable, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It is. I think he's going to have a big year. I think that the only thing that could get in the way is the daily Redskins dysfunction that just runs rampant through Redskins Park.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he's contributed to that. And I think that could get in the way if there's any bumps in the road, but if the road is smooth, I think he's going to have a standout year.
Talk to me about DeSean Jackson. I really don't know much about him, but he's being portrayed mostly as just an all-American boy. But I believe there was a point in time when he was sort of a problem child.
Yes. Yeah.
So who are we getting?
They're getting a talent, for sure.
All right.
I mean, they haven't had... They only, in the last few years, I mean, Robert and his... first year was a real game-changing player.
Oh my God, that was so exciting.
Right.
And
they haven't had real game-changing players. I think they've got another young one in Jordan Reed, the tight end, if he stays healthy. He is a potentially top three tight end in the league. DeSean Jackson, in terms of actually making plays that impact the result of a game, is top five, top ten in the league. So they haven't had anything like that from a talent standpoint. But you're right. There's a lot of baggage there, and this is a fresh start, and he's a little bit older. And the Redskins, to their credit, in the past, they would have traded four draft choices to get him here. They would have torn up his contract and given him, you know, what they gave Albert Hainsworth and other players, yeah. and yeah. there would have been no hunger, you yeah. know, once they got here. But they got a pretty good deal financially. If it doesn't work out, they're not going to be buried under this contract.
And he's getting a great second chance.
And he's getting a really nice second chance. And he's got revenge on his mind against a team in the division twice a year, Philadelphia. I think mm-hmm. he feels like he was wronged by that coach. So he's got a lot to prove. So I think that's a good situation for the team to be in.
You talk about top three players and elite and whatnot. Who are going to be the most favored receivers as the season begins for Griffin? I mean, who is...
Pierre Garçon, Jackson, Jordan Reed.
And Morris, is he?
And Morris will be a big part of that. The Reds, I mean, they've given Robert all the weapons. Offensively, this looks like a really dynamic team at the skill position spots anyway. And if he plays well, I think they're going to be very good offensively.
And what's
if they're not that good offensively, I think you'll hear it from the receivers. Pierre
and Garçon, they'll be blaming him.
Yeah, Pierre Garçon pretty much did that at one point last year. I don't think DeSean Jackson will be shy about it either.
And the defense?
Big question mark. Jim Haslett
is getting it. Talk about a second chance.
Yeah, and what Tommy mentioned earlier, there's this feeling that, you know, the bad guys are gone, and now we get to do our job because we've been shackled for 4 years and couldn't do what we wanted to do. So from that perspective, there's some pressure on Jim Haslett, too, to sort of perform now that he gets to coach the way he wants to coach. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of people are under that pressure out at Redskins Park. You know, Brian Arakpo and others that talked about, they weren't allowed to do things the way they wanted to do them. Well, now they're going to get a chance.
Isn't the most pressure on Gruden, though?
I think it is.
I think it's the quarterback.
I think it's more on the coach. And I think in part...
I love it when you disagree.
Whether on purpose or just by accident, I think RG3's social media campaign, where he's basically reaching out to Redskins fans and building his army, I think it's going to help him if things start going south. I think the blame, whether it should go on him or not, will go towards the coach.
Well, it's interesting.
I think the fan base will be much more loyal to this quarterback this year because he loves them.
I think the fan base wishes that he weren't putting together an army and were just focused on getting better.
I think
that he needs to play well.
Maybe instead of multiple photos on Instagram of himself with DeSean Jackson, maybe he should post one with Gruden, or maybe he doesn't want to give Gruden that much power yet until he sees how it plays out. I just one last question about the Redskins. Do you go down to Richmond to the camp
there?
We do.
Was that a good choice moving the team there? It was from Carlisle.
Well,
right?
I think it's been well.
No, it's been.
It was at Redskins
Ashburn.
Park.
It was Carlisle
Ashburn. Years ago,
and, yeah,
right.
And then
I think it was good to get out of Ashburn. I do.
Because they were all going home at night, right?
Right, to the old school notion that when you get them away from home and you get them together, I think it does help build a team. And it seemed like the experience was really good in Richmond last year. I mean, I enjoyed myself when I was down there, and things seemed to work pretty well.
You found
well
a cigar bar. You found a place to hang out. You made some new friends.
Yes, I did.
How long do you go
you
for? Do you go?
Well, we'll go for a couple of days at a time, and then come back, and then a couple of days at a time, and other shows go down too throughout training camp.
Well, do you mind if we change to the other subject, the Nationals?
No,
no, absolutely.
I was just at a game, you know, and
I was at the same game.
You didn't come down and say hello, or
well,
I didn't come up and say hello.
I didn't know you were
there
until
later. I don't
know
that I could even get in the press box.
3 hours and 42 minutes in 94-degree heat.
It felt okay, though, you know? I mean, I just love this team.
He complains about
everything. I love this team. I really do like the Nationals a lot. I mean, I grew up with the Redskins, too. They've made it difficult for me in recent years, but I've just found it really easy to like the Nats. And tell me about Steven Strasburg and Bryce Harper. Where are they at in the projected journey of their careers, you know, given where they started with us and our expectations and how they're adding up?
I was talking to one of the writers last night at Nationals Park. I'll be real curious to see how Bryce Harper handles himself when he comes back from this latest injury. If he comes back a little bit more humbled by his body, which has really kind of betrayed him since he started playing. he can't seem to stay healthy, or if he's still the chesty Bryce Harper, mm-hmm. you know, that that I'm going to be one of the best players in the game. I think he needs to be the humble guy. He needs to realize that he's only as good as if he's on the field.
Yeah.
And his reputation isn't going to help him much anymore. I still think he has a chance to be a mega star, but I'll be curious to see how he handles his coming back, how the team, which is playing okay now and in first place with a big series coming up, handles him being integrated back, because Ryan Zimmerman isn't the left fielder anymore when Bryce yeah. Harper comes back.
Yeah.
He's back to third base, where he's basically said, you know, I've had some problems at third base.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
now they're going to have to put him
and
right back.
And he's done okay in left field.
He's done very good in left
yeah.
field. Yeah.
Where does the team need to be after the All-Star game?
In that division, you know, within a couple of games of first. I mean, right now that division is really tight, and it's got the worst first-place record in baseball. And the Nats, you know, as we sit here today, are four games above 500, a game and a half in front of Atlanta and Miami. They just have to be within striking distance. When everybody comes back, when they get Ramos back too, that's a big miss right now. They need him back, and they get everybody back, and they're healthy, and they make a run. I mean, in baseball now, you've got two wild cards, so you just have to be within shouting distance of one of those spots. The randomness of the Major League Baseball playoffs, you get a hot pitcher, it's similar to hockey. You get a hot goalie, you just need to get into the tournament, so to speak, and you've got a shot.
The one thing is, as bad as people think the Nationals played last year, if it's not for the Pittsburgh Pirates having a once in a 30-year season, they're in the playoffs. I mean, they get that next wild card, that last wild card. So it doesn't.
Didn't last year have some RG3 syndrome to it, in that we were coming off that awesome year, and everybody was like, oh, well, they're on their way to the World Series. It's
and
done.
They thought so.
Right.
And they were talking the season started about winning record numbers of games.
The same people that predicted that last year are predicting it again this year. Every national writer that predicted they were going to do that last year.
Their manager didn't say World Series or bust.
Their manager didn't say World Series or bust.
No, no, no. I want it for Jason Worth because I adore him.
Yeah.
He's way too young for me. But I do adore him. Speaking of general managers, Matt Williams, has it been a smooth transition from Davey?
Tommy, in the first 3 weeks of the season, wanted him out of there.
Yeah, well,
no, I didn't.
Well, sort of.
That's his typical exaggeration.
You weren't happy with him.
Well, he's a rookie manager hired to manage a team that's ready to go to the World Series. And he's a rookie manager hired because he was cheaper than the other alternatives.
Well, that's not encouraging to hear.
That doesn't mean he won't be a good manager,
okay.
And he's done okay so far. But he is a rookie manager. And this is a team that's ready to go to the World Series. And every situation he's in as the pennant race goes on is going to be new for him. So,
who runs the clubhouse? Is it the veterans? Is it like Ryan Zimmerman?
It's Wirtz, Zimmerman, and LaRoche.
Yeah.
Which I think is also a problem, too.
Because?
Because it's a too low key of a clubhouse. I mean, the whole issues last year with the Braves and the Braves bullied the Nationals last year. They intimidated them. And there was no pushback from anyone on the team.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, at one point, somebody's got to, the 25th guy, somebody's got to come off that bench and charge the mound and say, you can't throw at our guys anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there is a fear that it's too laid back. I mean, Kevin Franston.
And that's the personalities of
those three
people.
Players.
Yeah, yeah.
Kevin Franston is a guy they picked up at the end of spring training, a very valuable utility player mm-hmm. they got when the Phillies released him. He's one of the leaders in the clubhouse now. He just got here. That's not
who
I don't
is
like
the
that.
Feisty guy in the locker room.
Well, there is. That's him. I just told you who he is.
But wasn't it Bryce Harper?
Well, that's not enough.
No, it's not. That's
what
a
about
problem.
Harper?
No, he's too busy being Bryce Harper.
okay. Well, I had something I called random stuff. just some things I wanted to go to that, because we only have, you know, the time is flying. You're having a good time, right?
We're having a great time.
Let's play two. Like Ernie Banks would say.
Yeah. Well, what do we need to know about the NBA draft and the Wizards coming up? You know, I mean, are the Wizards ever going to be in the conversation
in a bigger?
I mean, they did okay, but it always felt tentative.
You're from here, and you know that probably more people in this town participate or actively involved in the sport of basketball more than any other sport.
Yeah.
If the Wizards really become a legitimate contender, maybe we saw the first step of that this year. I think it's going to be a big deal.
Did the ticket sales go up as they did better?
The ticket sales were fine except for game six, which was the game that sort of came around and sort of with a very short buildup because they won game five at Indiana, which made it sort of a surprise that they were going to host a game six. But
They had to boot Lady Gaga out of there. People had to do their hair that night. That's why they couldn't show up for an NBA playoff game that decided the
season.
Things
matter.
Yeah, I know. Yeah,
I don't have any hair, which is why I showed up on time. But
I think that's why he made the joke.
I think they have a chance to be really good. And they don't have a draft choice of note. They have a second
round. Do they have the pieces in place? What do they need that they don't have?
They need to bring back everybody that was meaningful this year. Because I think the whole chemistry thing and staying consistent means a lot. And they're probably one player away from being a championship contender. But next year in the East, they should be a top three, top four team. I think they have a chance to win 50 games next year, which they haven't done since 1979.
Do you go to those games?
I do.
I don't, because I'm at war with somebody in the Wizards organization. And it's not Ernie Grunfeld.
No, okay.
I mean, I think
Ted
Ernie
Leonsis?
Grunfeld. No,
that's
not
another
Ted.
Story.
That's a different war.
That's a different
war. But, I mean, I think Ernie Grunfeld is a terrific guy, but I think that he had his shot with this franchise, and he ran it into the ground. And I think as long as he's a general manager, this team will never take the next step that they need to. I don't think any quality free agents of note will come here to be the missing piece. I think a guy who NBA Finals, Kawhi Leonard. You know, he wasn't the only one to pass on Kawhi Leonard in the NBA draft, but the Wizards drafted Jan Vesely instead of Kawhi.
How do you run an organization into the ground that's actually in the ground already?
Yeah.
How does that work?
Well, you know what? It takes a special talent.
It does?
It takes a special talent to do
it
that.
It must.
It takes
We've got 3 minutes. I guess this is going to be lightning rounds. The Caps, Ovi, did he get injured or didn't he get injured? Or what in the hell was that all about?
He got hurt, I guess, playing in the World Championships in Russia with the tournament that I think seems to be more important to him than the Stanley Cup, and they won this time.
Yeah,
so
I know.
He finally got that out of the way.
Yeah, I think he prefers playing for his country more than he does.
Well,
but now you got a new coach. You got a new GM.
I feel like I feel like we always have a new coach.
Yes. Everywhere.
Caps,
exactly.
Well, everywhere. You're right. Right. No, it seems like it's the fashion.
Washington.
Well, they got a new coach. Why don't we have one?
Washington is the elf and graveyard for people in sports. This is where their reputations come to die.
Yeah. But it didn't used to be that way. It's got to change.
No, come on. Please. That's okay, then explain why we gave the ratings to the U.S. soccer game. You know, I mean, that all came from
Washington. You have to talk to the soccer freak about that.
Yeah, right.
You know? The soccer
It is
fan.
Interesting that this World Cup, I mean, there's much more interest in the country than there was previously. I told Tommy
the other
day.
I think it's the hipster sport, and that's why.
There's a lot of this is a great party, and this is where you want to be seen, and, you know, big game, Ivory Coast and Chile. Let's go check that out. But you know what part of it is that there's the young people are really into the sport in part because the FIFA video game
is
wildly popular.
It was in
popular.
My house for a long time.
My kids, it's their favorite video game. They know all the players, all the teams.
Soccer, as I say, soccer is a sport for people who don't like sports.
Okay. What's the best area sports venue? What's your favorite place to go watch?
Comcast Center for me. For a big Maryland basketball game. There's no atmosphere in town that rivals that.
Nationals Park. I think, you know, they got a lot of grief when they built the ballpark that it wasn't like Camden Yards, the neighbor up the road. But, I mean, you can't compete with that. So you try something different. I think it's a comfortable, enjoyable place to watch baseball, and that's my favorite.
RFK for a Redskins game. Can we go back and see that again?
Yeah, there should be one just for the sake of it.
Yeah.
Of course, I think it would fall down.
Yeah, it might.
We don't want to do that. I wonder how much money you spend on pay-per-view watching sports events. I mean, and I'm hoping you can expense it. But how do you consume most of your sports?
Well, the only pay-per-view thing I've ever paid for are big fights.
Okay.
And Tommy usually is at the fight. They send him to Vegas for all the fights. He gets all the gigs.
I mean, he's banned from Vegas. He didn't tell you that.
That's another show, right?
But that's the only thing I've ever spent money
yeah,
on.
Yeah, it's boxing is pay-per-view. I just bought a pay-per-view fight not long ago.
Cotto
versus Martinez.
Yeah.
And it was a ripoff, it turned out to be. Yes.
But you do your show every day, weekdays, from noon to 2, and is every evening watching one sport or another? Are you just glued to ESPN then, or, you know, whatever's on? Or
we usually just sort of show up at 11:55,
make it up.
And yeah. What do you want to talk about? I'm a huge sports fan, so I would have been doing this if I didn't have the show. I would have been...
Even if you didn't get paid for
it. I like watching games, yeah, you know, and my friends and I like watching games and
talking
about games.
That's why other men envy you.
Well, I love watching games too, but one of us has more of a financial investment in some of these games than others.
Yeah.
And you have a job. You have the day job. Do you go to the Times?
No, I don't have to show up at the Times anymore. I just have to write my, like most newspaper guys, you just... Yeah. I mean, there's no more newsroom. I miss a newsroom.
Do you have gig? You have gigs outside of...
Occasionally, but my gig really is to keep him happy every day from 12 to 2 and to get it set up and get the food and drink in order so that when he walks into the studio, he's happy, because it doesn't always happen. And he's not the go-along, get-along guy that he appears to be all the time. I mean, he can really be hard to manage.
I guess here as we wind up, we're going to go back to football, and what's going to be fun to watch beyond the Redskins? I mean, you know, Johnny Manziel, RG3. I guess it'll be fun to see if Tom Brady can get it done at age 37. But who else? I mean, Andrew Luck is fascinating, isn't he?
Yeah.
I mean, the guy's, I met him. He's amazing.
Yes.
He's
the great thing about the
born
NFL.
Born in D.C., by the way.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
Great thing about the NFL is you just never know. Every year is a totally different thing, and it's totally unpredictable, and there will be a last place team from last year that'll mm-hmm. finish first. It happens every year. Half the playoff teams from last year will be out. Half the playoff teams in January of 2015 will be new, mm-hmm. and that gives teams like the Redskins some hope, because you're if you stay healthy and the ball bounces your way in the NFL, you can have a good season even if you aren't a good franchise. It happens every year.
Is this Tony Romo's last season?
Hopefully not. If you're a Redskins fan, you want to stay
keep
there.
I keep him around for laughs.
Yeah,
I think it's laughs. Always interesting to watch the Seahawks and the 49ers. Two of the two best teams in the league, the two hated rivals, and how they interact with each other. It's especially those two coaches.
The hated rivals of the last two seasons.
Right.
Right.
Well, it feels like the new crop of quarterbacks are really becoming pervasive now and throughout the league, and it's not just this kind of a pocket here, a pocket there, and it has, I think, made the game much more exciting.
Yeah, the Colin Kaepernicks,
Robert Griffins. They're fun to watch. They're fun to watch.
It's a different type of quarterback.
And I still love Tom Brady, too. So.
Yeah.
Okay, I know. I'm wrapping up, and I could have gone on for
where's the other random question or two?
We
had a whole list.
Yeah, I did. Right. I know, but we got to most of them. Well, because we put Johnny Football up higher. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I hope you'll come back. I know it was hard to get this done, but and let's end by giving our Twitter handles, because I bet you've got a big following. Thom Loverro is just at Thom Loverro, but it's T-H-O-M-L-O-V-E-R-R-O.
Yeah, I spell it that way because...
To make it difficult for people in social media.
Exactly.
And
at KevinS980.
And I'm at Carol Joynt, and that's J-O-Y-N-T. Thank you both very
much. Thanks, Carol.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Have a good summer.